From any sickness and disease. We are free from any unclean and demonic spirit. Why? Because our head is free. And whom the Son sets free is free indeed. And our Lord Savior Jesus Christ have redeemed us by his precious blood. And without the shedding of the blood, there is no remissions of sins. And therefore, our self-worth is in Christ Jesus, our mediator, our advocate. And we are confident that we know that nothing shall separate us from the love of Christ. Because his love constrains us more so, according to Hebrews chapter 1. Jesus sustained all things by the word of his power. And therefore, he sustains you and I right now. So, what can come against us? In the name of Jesus, we thank you. You may be seated. We thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, Christ Jesus, for being who you are. We thank you, Christ Jesus, for being who you are. I tell you the truth, that the end of the year is approaching, and many people wait until the end of the year, or the beginning of the year, and want to proclaim and say their resolutions. This is the year of breakthrough. This is a year of new opportunities. But I tell you the truth. Why wait till the beginning of the year? Why wait to the beginning of the year to have a resolution? Why wait to the beginning of the year to claim a change in your life? When it comes down to our Lord, when it comes down to the Father, to the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we know that God is always in a present tense form. We know that God is a deliverer. God is Jehovah. God is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So if our Father, in which he is always in the present state, why do we have moments and times that we proclaim a thing or we wait to a certain day and time to change? God is powerful. And when he brings about change, change can be about right then and there. So if change can come in an instant, that means when we speak a thing, when we set out to change, that means change can come in an instant. In an instant. We have the power, Brother Deacon, to change things right then and there. We have the power to make changes in our life right now. I say that to say that in this series that we're about to begin, at the end of the series, it is God's plan for you and I to understand how to be one with the Father. How to be one with the Father. You see, Jesus said, I am in the Father and the Father is me and we are one. And he is the greater one. And Jesus told us, if you abide in me, excuse me, and my words abide in you. We have the ability to be one with the Father. In the series that's being introduced today, when it's all said and done, it will take us through the steps in which we will know how to be one with the Father. What does it take to be one with Him? Through Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit. In Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3, it says, I have loved you with an everlasting love, and I have drawn you unto me with loving kindness, or by loving kindness. I loved you with an everlasting love, and with loving kindness I draw you to me. So He's drawing us, but there's a level and a place in our relationship with Him that we have to do. You see, back in the days, no one can come to the king except the king summon him or her. And by that scripture alone, the king, our creator, our father, draws us unto him. And this is the difference in why we journey in life and do not see no results. There's a difference between sometimes when we speak and preach and no power come out. There's a difference when we declare something, but yet still have unbelief in our heart. There's something that we have to do in order to be one with the Father in Christ, by the power and leading of the Holy Ghost. And that first thing, what does God require? Total surrenderance. Total surrenderance. You know, sometimes we do, but we don't. God tells us to go a mile, we go the half. But God is requiring of us, not waiting till the new year for a new resolution. He's requiring us right now of total surrenderance. In order for us to go into what we have to go into, I need to quickly break down total surrenderance. The word total means constituting a whole. It means complete. So, constituting a whole, and it means complete. So, surrender means to yield, look at this, surrender means to yield to the power, control, or possession of another upon demand. The second meaning of surrender means, while I'm saying this, you can turn to John chapter 14. The second definition of surrender means to give oneself over to somebody, to something, as an influence. So total surrenderance is complete yielding, complete control and power to someone else. In other words, in order to be one with the Father through Christ, by the leading and power of the Holy Ghost, as sons, we must give total, complete surrenderance, control over to God. to God. This makes the difference with an individual who hear the Lord and they keep hesitating. It makes a difference when one hears the Lord and don't believe. But not wait till the new year comes, that as God is and always is a present state, so we have the power to change things right now. And before we go into the series in this introduction, we must yield total surrenderance unto the Father. How is it that we want to experience God's full blossom of His glory and yet not still render your total control to Him, your total surrenderance to Him? John chapter 14, we start at verse 1. Everyone have it? Just leading up to this chapter, Jesus, the previous chapter, chapter 13, Jesus explained to the disciples there are some things that He must endure, and that there's one who's going to betray Him. And at the end of it, it leaves disciples a little disheartened, a little uncomfortable, a little sad, dismayed. And now, after Jesus said what He said to the disciples, chapter 14 come about, and Jesus said to the disciples, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in Me." A few years back, I was on the street and I told a young lady, I said, "You know, Jesus loves you." She said, "What about God?" I said, "Jesus is God." She walked away. I tell you the truth. Jesus said, "Believe in God, also believe in Me. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, also believe in Me. That in My Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." We know that God cannot lie. God cannot lie. He said, Jesus said, "If in My Father's house there are many mansions, if it were not so, I would have told you so." God cannot lie. What He say out of His mouth, you could take that to the bank. Because His word cannot return unto Him void. That's why, "Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, also believe in Me." Because I, God, cannot lie. "And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to Myself. That where I am, there you may be also." That we are seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That where He is, Christ is, there we are also. Verse 4, "And where I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas said to Him, "Lord, we do not know where you go or where you are going. And how can we know the way?" Then Jesus said to him, "I am the way. I am the way. I am the door. If any man enter Me, they are saved. I am the truth, because Thy word is truth. And Jesus is the word of God. And He said, I am the life." And for John 3:16 says, "For God so loved this world that he gave his only begotten son, and whosoever believe in him shall have everlasting life. And therefore he is life. And that he came that we may have life and have it more abundantly. So yes, Jesus is the way. He's the door. Yes, he's the truth because he's the word of God. Yes, he's the life because he came to give us life. Mm-hmm. And no one comes to the Father except through me. No one can come unto the Father except through Christ. If you, verse 7, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also. There's no way in the world that you can know Christ and not know the Father. Christ is God's most eloquent expression of his word. Christ is God's word that came into the flesh and dwelt among us. The latter part of verse 7, and from now on you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Jesus, verse 9, Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, Philip, and yet you have not known me? He who's seen me, Christ, has seen the Father. He who has seen Christ has seen the Father. Because Christ is in the Father. The Father is in Christ. They are one. And yet the Father is the greater one. So how, the latter part of verse 9. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. That Christ said, I only do what I see my Father do. Christ says what he hears his Father say. That he do not speak of his own authority, but it's the Father that's in him who do the work. It is the Father that is in Christ that does the works. Total surrenderance. Being in a place to the Father in total surrenderance. How is it that Jesus did what he saw his Father do? Say what he heard his Father say. With great success. Total, Jesus had total surrenderance unto the Father. Jesus had total surrenderance unto the Father. That whenever he spoke, it had to happen. He told one of the men that, the man told him, you don't got to come to my house. You just speak a word and it shall be so. Mm-hmm. Why? Because it's the Father that's in Christ who does the works. So God wants to get us to a place, not waiting to the new year, but starting now to get us to a place of total surrenderance where we can see total obedience. Meaning the results of total obedience. Jesus was always obedient unto the Father. And therefore, he always saw the results. to take place when he spoke healing. Deliverance had to take place when he delivered. The captives had to be free when he set the captives free. The chains had to be broken when he broke the chains. But it's the Father who dwells in me who does the work. Who's doing the work in you? Verse 11, believe me that I am in the Father. He reiterates again, believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me. Total surrenderance unto the Father where they are so one with each other. You notice Jesus never brought glory to himself. Everything that he did was glory to the Father. To the point where John chapter 17, he said, Lord, glorify me so I can glorify you. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Believe me for the sake of the works. What works? The works that the Father was doing in Christ Jesus. Verse 12, most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. He who believes in me, that the works I do, he shall do also. So, this is letting me know that as the Father is in Christ, and Christ is in the Father, and the Father does the work in Christ, and the Father has given Christ to be the heir of all things, in which he sustained all things by the word of his power, and Christ hath given all things to the church, which is you and I. And he said, look what he said. He said, the works that I do, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he shall also do. So that means, in order to do the works that the Father did in Christ, and Christ is doing in us and through us, we have to have total surrenderance as Christ had total surrenderance unto the Father in order to see these results. Christ always had results. In Mark, Jesus cursed the fig tree because it didn't produce fruit at that time. He cursed the fig tree, and then the next day, they walked past the fig tree, and Peter said, Jesus, Master, the tree whom you cursed has withered away. Jesus always saw the results of the Father working in him because he had total surrenderance unto the Father. I'm talking about having that power that is given to us through Christ. But we are not operating in that total power because we have to give total surrenderance to the point where we are not ourselves. We don't belong to ourselves. For even the Bible says the temple belongs to the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, that we were bought with a price. So even Paul said, the life I live, I live through the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Verse 12, I surely say unto you, who believes in me, the works that I do, he shall also do, and greater works than these he will do. Greater works than these he will do. So there's greater works for you and I to do when we are in total surrenderance unto the Father. Verse 13. And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Look at the steps. When one surrenders and total surrenderance unto the Father, and the Father does the work in him, whatever you ask in Jesus' name, I will do. How are we going to ask the Father when we are in disobedience? How are we going to ask the Father anything while we are in disobedience? That's like many who have children and they of age to clean up their own room. And you tell them to go clean your room. They do not clean the room. And then they turn around and ask you for money to get something. And one will say, I told you to clean your room. And then you turn and ask me for money. One has to be obedient first to receive the blessing, the anointing, the power, the chain-breaking power. That greater work shall that total surrenderance person, that Son of God do. Greater work shall he do. Verse 14, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Look what total obedience will get you. That you can go boldly to the throne room of grace. Bold as a son and humble as a servant. And ask the Father anything when you're in total obedience in Jesus' name. He said, I will do it. I will do it. Verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, we're talking about total surrenderance. If you love me, keep my commandments. Well, first of all, just stop for a second and talk about love. We know that there is a love that God has for mankind, because we created in his image. There's a love that God has for mankind, right? There's a love that we have for God, right? And then there's a love that we have for one another. Three different types of love. The one that comes from God to us, in which he gave his only begotten son. The love that we have for God, because we couldn't have loved God because we didn't know him. To the point where we love him because he loved us first. And then there's a love that the Bible says we have to ought for one another. That we have to love one another to the point where, how can you love God whom you don't see and not love your brother whom you see every day? Right? But look what it says. It says, if you love me. This love that we have for God, that Jesus is talking about when he said, if you love me, not if he loves us. He said, if you love me. So this love that we have for God, that Jesus is talking about, it's a love that is spoken, a love to his master, to a master. This love is basically a love that is spoken of to a master. In this case, this is a love that is spoken to our Father, God, Christ Jesus. And this love, it's having, let's turn real quick, bookmark John 14, and let's turn quickly to 1 Corinthians chapter 8. Verse 3. While you're reading, I'll be reading from the Amplified edition because it stresses this particular point. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, this is a love that Christ is talking about, of a love to a master. In this words, we're talking about a love that we ought to have towards our Creator, our Father. Right? Everyone have it? It says, 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 3, it says, But if one loves God truly, what it says, with affectionate reverence, with prompt obedience, and with grateful recognition of his blessings. I'm going to read it again. But if one loves God truly, meaning if one loves God truly with affectionate reverence, in which we reverence the Lord, if one loves God truly with prompt obedience and grateful recognition of his blessings, what it says, he is known by God. He's recognized as worthy of his intimacy and love, and he is owned by God. Do everyone see that? So, when we say that, when Jesus said, if you love me, what is he talking about? He's talking about, if you love me with an affectionate reverence, my God. If you love me with a grateful recognition of benefits received. Remember in Psalms, we talked about a couple of weeks ago, that the Lord is God and do not forget his benefits. So when we love God, we are great. We are in a place of grateful recognition of his benefits. And lastly, when Jesus said, if you love me, he's saying that if you love me, you will be prompt, or you will have prompt obedience, meaning you will have immediate obedience. We're talking about total surrenderance. I'm setting an introduction to where we're going. So here we say, we know that we have to have total surrenderance as Christ had total surrenderance to the Father. And we have total surrenderance to the Father through Christ by the leading and power of the Holy Ghost. Right? And that Jesus says that if you love me with affectionate reverence, meaning revering the Lord. You reverence the Lord with high esteem. That you tell the Lord who he is and not tell another man those same words. You're reverencing the Lord. You're putting God in a class, in a place all by himself. Affectionate reverence. Grateful recognition of God's benefits. Of grateful recognition of benefits received. That if you love me, you are in a place of grateful recognition of the benefits that you have received. And lastly, while I'm saying this, can you turn to Romans chapter 8? I'm talking about this love right quick. If you love me, you will have prompt obedience. If you love me, you will have prompt obedience. Come on. If I ask any one of you right now, can you go give me a piece of tissue? Will you not do it? Why? Because you love me, right? You love me. So when it comes down to the Lord, if you love the Lord truly, wouldn't it not have you to have prompt obedience unto the Lord? And that's what he's saying. That's what the Lord is saying today in total surrenderance. That if you love me, you will have affectionate reverence to me. If you love me, you will have grateful recognition of the benefits you received. That in total surrenders, if you love me, you will have prompt obedience unto me, which you will receive immediate results. Because that's what perfect obedience do. Perfect obedience receives a perfect result. And it's perfect because you've given it unto the Lord, and He is perfect. So Christ never said something and it didn't come to pass. He never cast out and the casting didn't come, the demon didn't come out. Whenever He spoke it for them to come out, they came out. Whatever He spoke healing, they were healed. Whenever He spoke resurrection and to the life, they came up. Come here, Lazarus. If you love me, you will have affectionate reverence, grateful recognition of benefits received, and you will have prompt obedience. Romans chapter 8. Starting at verse 28. Look what this love does. Look what this love Christ is talking about will do. Look in the results of total surrenderance unto the Lord. Look what this love will do. I'm not talking about the love God has for us, because we already know that. We're talking about total surrenderance, and He said, if you love me, the love that we have for God, look at this result. Verse 28, Romans 8 and 28, which says, and we know that all things, what? Work together for good to those who what? Who love God. So when we love God with an affectionate reverence, when we love God with a grateful recognition of benefits received, and when we love God in prompting in immediate obedience, we know that all things work together for our good for those who what? Love God. My God, He's telling something today. Total surrenderance. Again, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love God. To those who are the called according to His purpose. The ones that's called according to His purpose. For there's the part that says many are called, but only few are chosen. For the harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few. Brother, the ones that are called according to His purpose, the ones that are the few that are chosen, are the ones who answer God's, who answer the call back in total obedience, in which they receive the results of that. Verse 29, from whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. For whom He foreknew, and we know He foreknew you and I. Why? Because in Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5, the Lord tells Jeremiah, before you were formed in your mother's belly, He said what? I knew you. Before you came out of your mother's womb, I ordained you as a prophet of this nation. So God foreknew you and predestined you to be conformed into the image of his son. How are you being conformed without total obedience? God is getting us to a place where we see the same results that Christ has received. But it ain't going to come until we have total surrenderance. Total surrenderance. That is not about me, Lord. It's all about you. Even Christ, my Lord, even the time of the bitter cup, when he knew that he was about to face death, he felt the pressure. He felt the pressure so much where his sweat was turned into blood. He was felt the pressure so much. He said, Lord, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me. But look what love do. Love said, and later on, Paul, after searching and searching, and Paul finally, after researching, Paul said and clarified what Jesus saw that caused him to move forward and say nevertheless. Paul said Jesus saw the joy that was set before him, that it will please the Father. That Jesus saw the joy that it will please the Father to go through this thing. So you know what, Lord? Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. And Jesus did it with joy. Why? Because that's what love do. Love prompts obedience. Love calls you to be total surrenderance. Sometimes I get fed up. My wife asks me for a cup of water or something. I get, come on, why you can't get it? But the Lord is requiring of us total obedience. So you can receive the results of Christ. This is when God's power runs all through you as Christ had it. Where you see the results that everything had to conform to his word. Every time Jesus spoke it, it took place. And God wants us to be in that same place. In total obedience unto the Father through Christ by the leading and the power of the Holy Ghost. There's no way that we speak and there should be no change. There's no way that we declare and decree and there shouldn't be no change. There should always be change. Because we shall always be in total obedience unto the Father in Christ by the leading power of the Holy Ghost. So verse 29, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn, that Christ might be the firstborn among many brethren. That Christ is the firstborn of many brethren. Jesus was sitting down with the sinners. And one of the disciples came and said, Jesus, your mother's outside. He said, who is my mother? Who is my brother? Except they that do the will of my Father. The ones who do the Father's will, they my brethren. So yes, he be the firstborn among many brethren because Christ is the head and we are the body. So Christ is the image and the Father is conforming us as we in total obedience, he's conforming us to the image of Christ Jesus. 30, moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. whom he called, he also justified. Thank you, Father, for justifying us because you called us. And whom he justified, these he also glorified. So it is the Father's will that in you be total obedience and total surrenderance, that you will glorify the Father in being conformed to the image of his Son, Jesus the Christ. Verse 31, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? So in total surrenderance, if God before us, who can be against us? Can I read that one more time? What then shall we say to these things? If God before us, or if God is for us, excuse me, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Do you see that? How then that he shall not with him also, Christ, freely give us all things, that if we seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and what? All these things shall be added to us. Not seeking the things first, and then seeking, and that's what happens, y'all. We seek things first before we see God. And Solomon in Ecclesiastes says, all is vanity, vanities of all vanities, is as if we were chasing the wind. You're never satisfied, and this lies our thirst. And thirst, and thirst. And we keep on being thirsty because we are putting the wrong drinks into our mouths. We are putting the wrong things into our mouths and cause us to continue to be thirsty. And when I say our mouths, we're putting the wrong thing in our spirit. We put the wrong thing in our flesh. And it causes us to be continually thirsty. So he freely gives us things. Verse 33, who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen. See, I love it because it didn't stop there. It is Christ who died and also risen. Why? Because God is not dead. He is yet alive. He is the living God. Whenever you deal with the aspect of man, you're always dealing with the was of man. But whenever you deal with God, you're always dealing with the is of God, because God is always in the present state. God is my light and my salvation. Of whom shall I fear? God is the source of my strength. Of whom shall I be afraid? God is the author and finisher of my faith. So we're talking about God always is in a place of present tense. He always is. It is Christ who died and furthermore also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who makes intercession for us. God cannot fail, and therefore we cannot fail. Why? Because we have a mediator, an advocate, who conquered the grave, who was risen from the dead, who snatched the keys of hell and said, death, where is your sting? And now sitting on the right hand of the Father in the heavenly places. So if he didn't fail, how can we fail if he's our head? And he has given the power unto the church, according to Ephesians chapter 1 and 2. So if God is for us, who can be against us? That Christ is always making intercession on our behalf. He told Peter He said, the Satan desires to sift you as wheat, but I prayed for you. Who was he praying to? He prayed unto the Father. I prayed for you, Peter, that your faith will not fail you. And we have an intercessor. And that intercessor goes on our behalf. And our intercessor, our mediator, is not like a lawyer who has bad cases and he always loses. Our intercessor, our mediator, our advocate never loses. Why? Because we are assured by the blood of Jesus Christ, my Lord. We are the redeemed, and let the redeemed say so. Okay, verse 35. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, which you're going through? No. Shall distress? No. Shall persecution? I don't care how bad it is. It still ain't separating you from the love of Christ. Or famine? Yeah, you hungry. There's no food around. God still loves you. Or nakedness? No clothes. God still loves you. Or parole or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Verse 37. Yet in all of these things, what things? Because of the love of Christ, right? Yet in all these things, the tribulation, the distress, persecution, the famine, the nakedness, the parole, and the sword, and yet we are counted as sheep for the slaughter, but yet in all these things, no matter what you're going through, you cannot be separated from Christ's love, and yet in all these things, because he loves you with an everlasting love, we are more than a conqueror. Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him. Who's him? Christ Jesus, who loved us. Verse 38, for I am persuaded. Can we read that together? The last two verses? 1, 2, 3. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that nothing shall separate us from the love of God. That is in Christ Jesus. He done named God about everything. He covered everything. So that means nothing shall separate us from the love of God. Can we turn back now to John chapter 14? And I'll be closing. We're talking about total surrenderance, y'all. Remember a long time ago, the Holy Spirit happened to say that we will receive God's perfect gift in God's perfect time. That's predicated on our total surrenderance. Our total surrenderance unto the Father. So, back at 15, he says, if you love me, and we said the three things, meaning the affectionate reverence, grateful recognition of the benefits received, and prompt obedience. So if you love me, keep my commandments. This word keep just doesn't mean more than to obey. It just doesn't mean to obey. But this word keep means to watch over, to guard, to carefully preserve all of the teachings that Jesus have given us. So this word keep, he's saying that not just to obey it, but if you love me, you will keep watch over my word. Meaning the commandments. his commandment. You will guard that word. Why? Because there was a sower who sowed the word of God. And after the seed that was sown, here come the adversary come to snatch up that seed. So one must, when one loves Christ, one must guard the word that was been given to them. One must watch over it and carefully preserve that word. For the Bible says, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. How can a man cleanse his own way? By taking heed the word of the Lord. So keep my word, guard my word, carefully preserve my word. We're talking about total surrenderance. Verse 16, and I will pray. Look at this. Look at the steps, y'all. And when one is in total surrenderance, if you love me first and keep watch over, carefully preserve, guard my word, my commandments, I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper that he may abide with you forever. Who is this helper? The Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know the people in the world, they can't see truth. You know the people can't see truth. They in so much denial and so much in darkness. What is wrong is right to them. And what would be right is wrong to them. The Spirit of Truth, they don't know. The world don't know. They can't see him. But Jesus told the disciples, but you know him, my Lord. For he dwells with you, and he will be in you. I'm leading somewhere. This is the introduction. The Spirit of Truth, the Helper, will come, and he will dwell, for you know him, and he will dwell with you, and he will be in you. And Jesus speak of this, of being in them, because he is still present in the earth. And when he prayed, he said, I must go. In a little while, you will see me. And then in a little while, you will not see me, because I must go to the Father. And Jesus said, you will know the Spirit of Truth. For you know the Spirit of Truth, and he will be with you, and he will be in you. When Jesus ascended unto the Father, he said, I will pray that another helper will come. And that helper is a Holy Spirit, and he will be in you. When Jesus ascended unto the Father, and the appointed time hath came, the Holy Spirit was given in the disciples, were put in the disciples to the day of Pentecost. First, they were baptized with the Holy Spirit. And then when the day of Pentecost came, a mighty fresh wind came into the place, my Lord. And everyone began to speak in an unknown tongue. But the time was not as yet that the Spirit will be in them. So he said, he will be in you. That it will come that he will be in you. Verse 18, I will not leave you orphans. And he said, I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. Thank the Lord that we are not bastards. That we are not orphans. That we have a Father who sits on the throne. And regardless of what we have or don't have, he remains on the throne. Regardless of how we feel today or tomorrow, he still remains on the throne. Regardless of how emotional we are, guess what? The Father still sits on the throne. And even Jesus said right here, right now, he said, I will not leave you orphans. So that means we're never alone. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will be with you until the end of the world. Verse 19, a little while longer, and the world will see me no more. Here we go. But you will see me because I live, you will live also. Jesus said, I live, and you will live also. At that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Here we go. Here we go. Total surrender is where we are in one unity with the Father in Christ by the leading and power of the Holy Ghost. Look what he said. He said that in that day, you will know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. So the Father is looking for total obedience from us as he loved us with an everlasting love, and he draws us close to him with his loving kindness for us to be in total surrenderance and one in unity with the Father and the Son by the leading and power of the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. Setting the stage. Verse 21, he who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. So if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. It is he who loves me, and he who loves me will love, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Right? And Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not the world? And Jesus said unto him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. If you love God, you will keep his word. Every day, all day, that the book of the law shall not depart out of my mouth. That I shall meditate on a day and night. If you love me, you will keep my word. Why? Because it is his word who sustains you and I. If you love me, you'll keep my word. Right? And my Father will love him. So the Father loves the ones who keeps his word. Right? And my Father will love him, and we, look at this. And we will come to him and make our home with him. Do you see that? When we are in total surrenderance and we love and we love God and we keep his word and the Father loves us, Jesus said, we will come, my Lord, we will come. We will come and we will make our home with him. We will come and make our home with him. Total surrenderance. That we are not of this world. We are just pilgrims just passing by. That we are in the realms of the Father. We're just here, just pilgrims just passing by. And therefore, we got to speak and act and do things of the realm which is our head in Christ Jesus. Because he is our advocate in heavenly places. And therefore, when we keep God's word, it keeps us in heavenly places. He said, I'll come. We will come and make our home with him. He who does not love me does not keep my words. And the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. That the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. And in my closing, I'm learning. That surrendering is not a one-time thing. Jesus constantly left the disciples and went on his own, secluded, and he was with the Father. He had total surrenderance, and not just that, he knew that it was an ongoing thing. And I understand that I have to keep on surrendering. Keep on bowing my heart unto the Lord. Keep on bowing my knees unto the Lord. I understand that I have to keep choosing to live my life like God's, like Christ is in charge of my life. Having total surrenderance. We have to keep mindful and keep choosing that my life, that our lives belong to God and that they are in charge. Last scripture, Psalms 139. And this is my prayer. I'm ending with a prayer. Total surrenderance. Total surrenderance. 139, verse 23 and 24. Does everyone have it? Verse 23 and 24. Before I go further, I urge you, they that's in front of me and they that's watching me, the whole scripture, the whole chapter of 139 is a prayer. But on your own time, you can read that. But I want to capture the last two verses, which says, and which is our prayer, Lord, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties, and see if there are any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting. So in order that we not wait till the new year for any resolution, for when change take place, we have the ability to make change now. And that we do not wait till the end of the year, to the beginning of the next year, to make a choice to choose to be in total surrenderance unto the Lord. For in the scripture it says, he that have an ear, let him hear. And he also says, today he stands at the door knocking. If any man hear my voice, harden not your heart. That He has given me this word to begin the series, and that in order for change to happen, in order for us to experience the full blossom of His glory, for change, for deliverance, for power and anointing, to be active in the heavenly realms, we must be in total surrenderance unto the Father in Christ, by the leading and power of the Holy Ghost. It's imperative. That when the moment comes, when the opportunity for change comes, that we take hold to the change and not procrastinate and not wait. Because when one procrastinates after hearing the word of the Lord, and misses the opportunity, we do not know when the Lord is going to send back the opportunity. And then we begin to go through process and cycles and change, meaning going through certain difficulties in which we didn't have to experience if we had just obeyed from the beginning. Total surrenderance unto the Lord. Total surrenderance in today's title of the message is what is leading us into really going into and introducing the Holy Spirit. And in order for God to totally move in our lives, we must first have total surrenderment unto Him. So Lord, we surrender on today our emotions. We surrender our fears. We surrender our insecurities, Lord. We surrender our entire life to you, Christ Jesus. The past, the present, and we even surrender our future unto you. That, Lord, you will have total surrendered control over our lives. That we be one with you, Christ Jesus, as you are one with the Father. To receive powerful, effective, efficient results in you, Lord. That we no longer going to wait for no New Year's resolution. But we desire change today. And for that purpose, we will not be the same anymore. Because the truth be told, you do what you want to do when you want to do it. Why not change today and surrender total and have total surrenderance unto our Lord Creator, our Father, in which you will have the benefits of it anyway. Why? Because he said, my thoughts towards you are good, are peace, and not evil. And he said, lay up your treasures in heaven and not in the earth, where the thief comes, because the thief comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. We don't know when another opportunity is going to come. And I tell you the truth, as for me, Pastor Ahmed Dacruz, I am not the same person anymore. I refuse to be the same person. I'm no longer that person anymore. The person you begin to see is the person that is one with the Father in Christ by the power and leading of the Holy Ghost, who only speaks what the Father say, who only perform and do what I see the Father do.
Yes.
With the Holy Spirit in me, because the Bible says that is not by might nor by power, but it's by my Spirit, says the Lord. Until next time, my friends, be blessed and be encouraged. But make that choice today, total surrenderance unto the Lord. You want mountains to be moved. You want chains to be broken. You want to speak and power and change comes to the hearers when you speak. I challenge you. Back in the days, they used to say, I double dog dare you to surrender, total surrenderance unto the Lord. This is the introduction of leading up to the Holy Spirit. Because Jesus said, I pray to the Father that another helper will come. The Spirit of truth, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. And that now He is in us. And they that are led by the Spirit of the Lord are the sons of God. Until next time, my friends, be blessed, be encouraged. And don't forget to visit www.myfamilyworships.com. God bless you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.